Yeah, thank you very much for having me and giving me the opportunity to talk a little bit about the topic, about artistic responses to plastic pollution in the oceans. And I would like to start with a story how this topic became aware of that topic. And in 2012, a then young artist, and still young, Pina Yoldas, she dropped me an email. And this email was just fantastic because she was coming to Berlin, and I said, oh, fantastic, we could meet. And she wanted to do a project on art and plastic pollution in the ocean. There was hardly anything about that topic at that time. And it was very difficult to get funding to put up an exhibition, but Pina was able, with the help of a number of people in Berlin, to set up an exhibition at the Schering Foundation. It's a very small art and science foundation in Berlin, but they have Unter den Linden, very close to the Brandenburg Gate, they have a nice little showroom, and there we could show the an ecosystem of excess. And what she did was something very speculative. She said, well, there are a number of marine organisms, and they will all have to adapt to this plastic soup, she called, and other scientists she had involved in the catalog called about the Plastisphere. And so she came up with the idea that showing organism or designing organism that would have been able in the near future to adapt to this plastic soup would be something that would raise awareness to the current situation. And she started with drawings and with a picture from Life magazine. These organisms or these creatures she was putting in glass and showing, organisms, how organisms could look like when they adapt. And she came across that topic because she saw on TV a photograph and a video by Chris Jordan, who is a photographer. And when looking at that image, this is not like a speculative design or any artistic endeavor. It is, showing a seabird that was eating plastic and then dying. And this is a topic that Chris Jordan was also, involved with for a long time. And also, with the series Intolerable Beauty, Portraits of American Mass Consumption. And this was something that Pina was very interested in, and then came to her idea of making this exhibition. The idea that artists work with garbage or waste is a very old idea. We see this around 1920-25 with Schwitter and others. And of course, also like with this Swiss artist Tina Hauser, artists go to the places where the garbage is and show this is the downside of our consumerism. And this is a more recent piece by Hanswer, The Tipping Hall from 2019. So we have artists going there, also curator showing the thing itself, I could call. And what Pina did was more like artistic, speculative, very aesthetic. And this was her artistic approach. And it is very important. It is very important that this topic is on the agenda, because I have two slides for you to show the massive scale of this challenge. It's not just a problem, but it's really massive when you see how much plastic was produced in 2050, and here's 2015, and it will rise and rise and rise. And what goes together is the production of CO2. Because of course plastic is made of crude oil. So, and what you also see here is what we have now at Sharm el-Sheikh. You have, you know, that institution that come together, politicians think about how we could do it a little bit less damage to the planet. But in when you look at the numbers, at the statistics, things are really things are not developing the way they should. But you see in the diagram, you see here, like that it goes a little bit down. This is what the crisis of 2000, the banking crisis, and this is the only reason why the production of plastic went down for a wee minute in human history. And plastic pollution is a major global challenge. There's a gap between high problem awareness and plastic-related behavior. Habits and social factors influence plastic-related behavior most, and political and psychological intervention are successful but understudied. And therefore, we have a lot of artists around the globe, especially in the US, coming together, and like here, the Plastic Pollution Coalition, organized by Diana Cohn, and you have 1,200 organizations. Now there are much more, and the artists involved, like Pina Yoldas, for example, she's part of that that institution, that NGO. They come up and showing that these are very urgent and pressure topics, like plastic pollution is an environmental and social justice issue, plastic pollution in cross borders and sectors, plastic pollution and climate change are parallel global emergencies. And here we have, as a last point, plastic pollution is toxic to human health, but of course also to all other organisms on this planet. And now I will show you, as a second part of my talk, a few examples of recent artistic strategies that were developed to bring more awareness and experience to this topic, like we see in this exhibition as well. So the first slide I would like to show is by an American artist, Victoria Vesner, based at the UCLA in California. Pina Yoldas studied with her before, so it's like she runs in the family a little bit. But Victoria, what she does, she's working a lot with high tech, and of course she has resources available that Pina, for example, had not in 2012, 2014. But what she did, it's very amazing, working on plankton, because plankton is, you know, like the bottom of the food chain, very, very important. And this piece is called Noise Aquarium, but it also refers to plastic pollution in the ocean. And she used fantastic visualizations from science scientists and from science visualization, and also had a work together with sound designer, because you enter, this is a picture here from Ars Electronica, you enter the room, it is extremely noisy, it really hurts you when you go there. And the way you move within the space, the organisms somehow react to you. So it's a kind of interactivity. And she used, for this piece, visualizations by Martina Fröschl and Alfred Wendel, who are, you know, like specialized in science visualizations, and bringing this to a broader audience, like these two. And those images were produced by scientists in Vienna, by Thomas Schwacher and Stefan Hanschuh. And this is very interesting because they are so small, overlooked, people do not really understand what kind of effect this has on anthropogenic noise pollution to organisms like plankton or plastic pollution. And so this is high tech, this is very complex, this project. It was shown all over the world, and also on the cover of Leonardo, I guess, if I remember correctly. And so this is just one of many strategies, and I want to show you a second artist going a completely different way. And this is a Canadian artist, but she, Max Liborian, but she was educated in New York, educated in US, And she looked, you know, in her PhD, she studied art and then cultural sciences, and she looked in her PhD in 2012 how we could refer to plastic pollution in a different way. And she started like this one, like sea globes, in a very funny way, showing like the Hudson River looks like, how it looks like close to New York, and not, you know, showing some imagery that is, you know, like something you take home, but showing, you know, like an image how the river or the riverside really looks like. And then she went back to Canada, and now she's a professor in geography and has a laboratory, but she's still working on plastic pollution and the effects here, for example, on fish. Fishery is a big topic also in the exhibition, and her idea was to show that the plastic pollution within our food chain is designed in a way that we hardly can see the difference. And I show you one picture that was done in her laboratory, because it's very difficult. This is, you know, the inside of the gut of a fish. It's very difficult to see what is natural, what is artificial. So what you have is a picture, and you have, you know, a lot of questions. Is this, you know, like, is this nature? Or can we address this as nature? And of course, she makes very beautiful photographs from these very, very tiny, tiny plastic particles. And what I think is interesting, and this is something, I guess, you know, from a perspective of curatorship, difficult to show, is what they do in their laboratory at Memorial University in Newfoundland. And the laboratory is called Civic Laboratory for Environmental Action Research, CLEAR, as a feminist anti-colonial marine science laboratory, which means our methods for ground values of humility, equity, and good land relations. We work doing science differently. And the question could be, why is this university spending, I wouldn't say much money, but a decent amount of resources in coming up with a lab like this, and having someone like Max Liborion as inaugurated as a professor? Yes, because they had big problems, because they had the collapse of the Atlantic cod stocks in 1992. And here I show you another diagram. You see, things go well, starting in 1850, and there's more and more and more fishing, 1940. But then in the 1960s, when after the Second World War, there was an enormous amount of fishers caught. But then things went down. The fishery here, it collapsed, and there was zero in 1992. And as we all know, there's no recovery from zero. And 40,000 people lost their jobs. And when you look what the scientists said, what the politicians did, what the people running the economy did, they all did the wrong thing. Now things are a little bit better, of course, but still, when you see, when things go wrong, you have to treat nature and, you know, your resources in a more, I would say, intelligent or more, in a way that things do not go out of hand like this. And Max Liborion is also a member of a group thinking and writing about discard studies, because we have to have a new way of thinking about pollution, waste, and why do we waste resources, and so on. And of course, she's publishing on this topic. Pollution is colonialism is a wonderful read, and also discard studies. So you see, she started as an artist, went into science, or art and science. Now she is a professor in a scientific field, publishing in scientific journals, and still making art. So you see, there's a very interesting journey. The last artist I would like to show you is doing things again very differently, a very different strategy. And this is Mary Magic. She's an American-Chinese artist based in Vienna. And this is also, you know, like she's also, you know, like interested in scientific research, but also in theory. Whenever she talks about what she's doing, like the photometrics, digital illustration for the project Genital Panic, she shows the, or tries to show the effect, what happens when the waters are contaminated with plastics that act in our bodies as estrogen. So all the male bodies become more female and so on. And this is a very different way of looking at things. And with her, especially this is the last project I would like to show now in my talk, is open source estrogen, also working with scientists. What she's also doing, I skipped this slide, what she's also doing is having an approach with DIY bio, showing how we could extract estrogens from our urine, for example, and also reflecting on plastic pollution in our bodies, and but bringing this together with queer, I would say, queer theory and people from her queer community, and this is a most wonderful, very very funny video. House open source estrogens, houseways making drugs, and this is very very funny because the topic is extremely serious, but the way they present it is very good. And and what happens now in museums and exhibitions? This, for example, this is my last slide. This, for example, is now part of a museum exhibition, although it just started with DIY equipment. And when she was putting this together a couple of years ago, she never ever could imagine that this would end up in a museum. So my idea was to show you that this is a very interesting topic, a topic that is also, you know, here shown in this exhibition. And currently we have a lot of artists approaching this topic with very different strategies. But what they all do is trying to reflect on it, but also to show that there's a kind of empowerment, that especially what Mary Magic does is this doesn't have to be the result or the end. We will have the opportunity to step in and be aware of that. Thank you for your patience.